My name is Karen Gutierrez. I manage the school and teacher programs here at the Asian Art Museum with my colleague Monica Butler. So many of you are familiar, and thanks for coming back. And it's also really exciting to see some new faces. So we're really grateful to have you here, and very excited to be partnering with Rachel Reinhardt and the UC Berkeley History Project. So if you didn't have a chance to pick up some of their materials at the front table, please do so. They do amazing programs, and this workshop we're doing today is very much modeled after an institute that they held based on a course at UC Berkeley.
So our speaker today is Nicolas Tackett. He's an associate professor in the Department of History, and his research area of focus is death and death rituals in early and mid-imperial China. So he'll be talking about the same sort of types of artifacts, but from a different period in time. So I feel lucky to be able to introduce Nicolas Tackett to speak to you today.
Great. Thank you. So there's quite a bit I wanted to talk about. I myself actually work on a slightly later period, on the Tang and Song dynasties, so 7th through 13th centuries. But there are nevertheless interesting continuities, and I'll tie things together over the course of my presentation. So I'm going to talk about, my plan is to talk about a series of specific topics. I want to make a few introductory points. I then want to talk about elements of death ritual that I think are particularly important, the ancestral cult and also the tombs as a place of residence for the deceased. And then I will also mention certain other beliefs and practices. And one of the points I am making is that there is a series of different sorts of practices and beliefs that circulate widely, that circulated widely in traditional China, and they don't always all make sense together. They are contradictory in a variety of different ways, and nevertheless, they coexisted with each other. Okay, so a few introductory points to begin with. one of the issues that, and this is just a series of points I want to make to set up the subsequent discussion essentially as caveats, that I don't want to oversimplify the reality of the situation. So one of the important points is that there were significant variations in beliefs and practices by region and also by socioeconomic stratum. This, I think, is not too surprising. China was, of course, significantly larger in area than Western Europe, and to the extent that one finds a variety of regional cultures in Western Europe in traditional times, of course, one also finds that in China as well. On the map on this slide, I've just as one illustration, I've marked two different types of tombs. One marked in red, consisting of chambered tombs with domed roofs, and these are all tombs dating roughly to the 11th, 12th, and 13th centuries. And then in blue, I'm sorry, the other way around. Blue is the chambered tombs with domed roofs, and then red are these small rectangular tombs that come in pairs, where the deceased couple, the male and female, are buried next to each other in these small separate chambers that are often linked by a very narrow corridor that is much too small for an actual person to pass through, but which presumably the spirits of the deceased were able to pass back and forth through these narrow passages. So these are two architecturally very, very different types of tombs, and they are found in different regions, such that there is a clear north-south divide regarding these tombs. So again, an illustration of the fact that there were significant variations in beliefs and practices by region, and then also by socioeconomic stratum. I also want to point out that there were significant changes over time. I'm going to try to stress certain ideas where one can recognize long-term continuities, but nevertheless, it's important to bear in mind that things did change quite substantially. I'll try to give a few examples. One of the important examples is the introduction of Buddhism to China in the beginning of the first millennium, and Buddhism became increasingly significant in impacting how people thought of the afterlife, and this, of course, added yet another element to the complexity of death and death ritual in traditional China. It was something that was completely absent in the Han Dynasty, but in later centuries would become increasingly important. I also want to point out that a lot of the what I will be talking about is really not associated with any particular named tradition. Often when talking about China, we talk about Confucians, Buddhists, Taoists, but in fact, these are practices that were not specifically tied and did not originate with any of these particular traditions. The people we refer to as the Confucians did come eventually to play an important role in prescribing particular ritual practices that were appropriate. And so in some sense, they co-opted elements of an earlier tradition, but these traditions were not rooted in, they emerged prior to Confucianism, prior to anything Confucian. They were rooted in something much earlier. And I will try to give you examples and evidence for this. And then the last two points I wanted to make is that the various traditions I'm going to talk about that did not always make sense together were never necessarily systematized into a coherent a belief system. So there's no simple explanation for what happens after death, what are the proper death rituals to perform, and why does one perform those particular death rituals. These were never systematically explained. When looking at traditional China, there were sets of beliefs that circulated. Some of them contradicted each other, but nevertheless, they all circulated together. Okay, now to set up the next part of my presentation, I want to point out that according to a number of classical texts, the deceased, when the person dies, it's imagined that they have two souls and that these souls separate. There's the Hun soul and the Po soul. The Hun soul is seen as something that rises up at the moment of death and remains above ground, and then the Po soul sinks down into the earth. And one way in which this is conceptualized is to think of the Hun soul as being related to the ancestral spirits that still played a role in the world of the living, whereas the Po soul resided in the tomb. And the goal of much of Chinese death ritual was to keep that soul in the tomb, and therefore to establish an agreeable and pleasant place to live in the afterlife. And so for that reason, I'm going to talk then about ancestral worship and then tombs as happy homes for the deceased. One example that I wanted to give again as a part of my introduction to this topic is a description of a death of the death rituals as described in a 17th or 18th century novel, Chinese novel. And here I think it's a very nice illustration of this fact that you have a number of different traditions that coexist together, that are not brought together in any clear and coherent fashion. So you have the head of the household first summoning in an expert who can determine an auspicious date for the various funerary events. So this is already one expert who was brought in who's associated with one particular tradition. Then you have this same head of household hiring a number of Buddhist monks to perform, to intone and chant for a period of 49 days. And then you also have him hiring a number of Taoist priests who also perform ceremonies during this period of time. People erroneously try to apply Western and modern conceptions of religion to how these various practices were practiced in traditional China. Nobody other than the religious specialists themselves, that is the Buddhist monks or the Taoist priests, would have referred to themselves as a Buddhist or as a Taoist, would have identified with these particular practices. It made no sense in traditional China to say, I am a Buddhist or I am a Taoist. What one did was one saw a variety of different teachings as providing options things one could, sources of knowledge that one could pick and choose from in order to deal with particular problems. And this, too, I think is important for understanding this variety of different practices and beliefs that circulated and for making sense of the fact that in fact, you can't come up with a single coherent way of explaining all of these different phenomena. Okay, so now I want to say a little something about the ancestral cult. And the basic point I want to make is that the ancestors of family members played an important role from a very early period, from the earliest written records, that is the oracle bones that date to as early as 1200 BC. There is evidence that the ancestors played an important role in the world of the living. They remained in the world, floating around in the air, and they could have an impact on the living and on what happened to them in their lives. All we really know about the ancestral cult in the very early period, that is in the Shang Dynasty, concerns the family of the king, himself. The ancestors of the Shang King are frequently referred to in the oracle bone inscriptions. So these oracle bones all took the form of various divinations, trying to determine what would happen or how to explain particular phenomena. You had either the turtle plastrons or bovine scapula on which were used for divination. A hot poker would be applied, there would be a popping noise, and that noise, or possibly the pattern of the cracks, would be interpreted by a specialist. But the interpretation concerned a specific, essentially a yes or no question, trying to determine how to explain a particular problem or how to resolve a particular problem. And so in this particular example, you see in the first case, apparently the king is ill and the diviner is trying to determine if it's his deceased grandfather who is angry at him and causing him to be ill. In a second divination, the one marked 10 here, apparently the king has a sore tooth and is trying to determine whether it is his deceased father who is angry at him and causing him to have this deceased tooth. And then further down, the diviner is noting that there is some sort of drought. which is going to have a negative impact on the harvest, and is trying to determine if a very early ancestor of the royal lineage is, again, angry, and if this explains what is happening. Once it has been determined if there is an angry ancestor, then the necessary sacrifices can be performed in order to try to get the ancestor to be happy and to cease causing these problems. But again, what we see from this very early period, well before Confucius, is that there's already an idea that there were ancestral spirits, that they had an impact on the world of the living, and that to the extent one could keep them happy, this would help ensure good fortune for the living. This sort of communication between the dead and the living is also apparent in a somewhat later period in Chinese history. When you move forward from the Shang Dynasty to the Western Zhou Dynasty, so the period roughly 1000 BC to 700 BC, In the early Western Zhou, there are a number of ritual bronze vessels have been excavated, and a number of which are on display in this museum. And these bronze vessels, as well as bronze bells, are also played a role in communicating with the ancestors, suggesting once again that the ancestral spirits were important, and a tremendous amount of resources were devoted to communicating with them, keeping them happy in order to maintain the good fortune for the living. These vessels typically have a message cast into them, such as I've indicated on this slide. And these messages varied, but often they involved a living descendant having made a significant accomplishment. In this particular case, it was on the battlefield. Because of his success in battle, he was rewarded by the king with with money or actual raw material to cast the bronze, which was then cast in the honor of his ancestor. The message on this inscription then, it's very clear that so he says, "Your son Dong bows and touches his head to the ground in response, extolling his cultured mother's fortune and valor, herewith making for his cultured mother of the day Gung this treasured sacrificial Gui tureen." So he's producing this tureen for his mother, who is deceased. It is used in part to communicate a message to the mother via the bronze vessel, which is then used in ancestral sacrifices. And it is also used, this tureen is itself used to feed the ancestors, the steam coming up from the food that is heating up in these sacrificial vessels feeds the ancestors and helps to ensure that they remained happy. There is an interesting account of one of these feasts of the ancestors in a very early text that's survives. That it's not an excavated text like the bronze vessels, but rather a transmitted text included in the what is variously known as the Book of Songs, the Classic of Odes, that is one of the five classics of the very early period. And in it, one actually has a description of one of these feasts for the ancestors. So I'll go ahead and read this. "They attend to the furnaces with reverence. They prepare the trays, which are very large, some for the roast meat, some for the broiled meat. The guests and visitors present the cup and drink all around." So at this point, you have a scene of the vessels being used to heat up both food and wine. But then the poem goes on to explain that the spirits, that is the ancestral spirits, quietly come in and respond with great blessings. Myriads of years are the fitting reward. The able priest announces the will of the spirit and goes to the filial descendant to convey it. So the surviving descendant, the head of the household, plays a particularly important role in this ritual. Fragrant has been your filial sacrifice, and the spirits have enjoyed your wines and meats. They confer upon you 100 blessings. So again, the goal of this sacrifice is to please the spirits and receive their blessings. This text, though it is included in one of the five classics, which became very important in the traditional period, describes rituals that, again, predate Confucius, rituals associated with bronze vessels of the early Western Zhou period, and again, suggesting that already this was a well-established practice, the worshiping of the ancestral spirits in a very early period. Now, jumping forward in time, I simply want to point out that indeed this became tremendously important, the cult of the ancestors in much later periods of time. In the very early period, in the Shang Dynasty, we only really know about the ancestral cult as it was practiced by the king himself. In later periods, in the Zhou Dynasty, we know about the cult as it was practiced by the great lords who could afford these expensive bronze ritual vessels. We know much less about what the rest of the population was doing. But by the late imperial period, so jumping forward 2,000 years to the middle of the second millennium of the Common Era, people all over China at all socioeconomic levels were practicing rituals that were intended to keep their own ancestors happy. One of the very good examples of this is the fact that households all over China would have ancestral tablets in their homes at a either in on an altar within the house itself or in an ancestral temple within the village, generally speaking. So this image here is a lineage temple with a very large number of ancestral tablets. Each one of those little rectangles is the tablet of a single deceased individual. It was believed that the ancestor was residing in that tablet, and so by performing rituals before the altar, this was an efficient way to feed the ancestors and make sure they remained content. There's an interesting example of this from the mid-16th century to demonstrate sort of how this worked, how the fact that that really it was believed the ancestor was there in the tablet. This comes from the final instructions of a very important minister who was executed in the middle of the 16th century. He was later thought of as a martyr, that he had in fact been giving good advice to the emperor, but the emperor didn't appreciate his advice and executed him instead. So in his final instructions to his descendants, he wrote a very lengthy letter that explained everything they were supposed to do, all of the ways they were supposed to behave correctly throughout their lives. And it's interesting, though, that he then stresses that the basic principles included in these final instructions should first be shown to their mother, so he's giving this to his sons. Then they should make a cloth bag to contain it and place it in front, or place it on the altar in front of my spirit tablet. And then each month, on the 1st and the 15th, the whole family, young and old, should worship and sacrifice before my spirit, take this hand scroll and read it out loud from beginning to end, the whole family listening. Even if there are urgent matters, do not abandon this practice. And basically, so he wants his sons to constantly remind themselves of the proper behaviors as outlined in the subsequent portions of this letter. But it's interesting that he then has them read it in front of his ancestral tablet. Why does he have them read it in front? So that he can check up on them. He's in the ancestral tablet. He'll know if they're doing that as they are supposed to twice a month on all subsequent months. So again, the ancestral tablets and the idea that the ancestral spirits were there and were had the possibility both to protect the family and their descendants and to cause them harm if they were not being adequately taken care of was very fundamental to how people thought of death in traditional China. I want to make a couple of comments then about how the Confucians, what their contribution was to these particular practices. It's very common to describe this ancestral cult as a Confucian thing. It's the norm to do so. I have tried to stress that it was in fact based on pre-Confucian beliefs, very early beliefs. And I think that the best way of understanding the relationship between the ancestral cult and the Confucians is to think of the Confucians as essentially having co-opted these beliefs and practices for their own purposes. On the one hand, the Confucians did provide very precise ritual prescriptions that there was one and only one correct way of sacrificing to the ancestors, depending on your particular official rank or lack of official rank, depending on whether you were male or female, depending on your your relationship to the deceased ancestor. All of this helped define how precisely you were to practice perform the rituals properly. The people we refer to as Confucians, in fact, they were largely ritual masters. Those who were at court were one of their major duties was looking after the rituals that the emperor himself performed, both with the goal of maintaining the dynasty, maintaining the stability of the dynasty, but also as the emperor was seen as a cosmic pivot whose role was to maintain harmony between the cosmos and the human world. And there too, those rituals became important, and the people we refer to as Confucians played a role in defining these precise rituals. Now, besides their role in providing very precise prescriptions for the rituals, the Confucians also gave these rituals a moral significance and gave these ancestral rituals a political significance as well. The moral and political significance is best understood by the concept that if one properly revered one's ancestors, then one would also properly revere political authority, so that there was a link between the practice of ancestral rituals and social stability and the maintenance of the dynasty that was then in power. And then finally, one could argue that the Confucians, although this was not always the case, but that sometimes the people we refer to as Confucians de-emphasized the religious elements of these ancestral rituals. This was not always the case, but often it seems as though they tried to emphasize the moral and political aspects of these rituals rather than the idea that these families were actually feeding real spirits and keeping those spirits happy. One of the good examples of this skepticism about the reality of the spirits is from a famous passage from Xunzi, who is one of the early Confucians of the classical period. And I won't read this whole quote, but he's describing what the sacrificial rites actually do. What is the purpose of the sacrificial rites? And he wants to emphasize that what they do is to properly give properly give form to one's feelings, one's sorrow for the death of a parent or a grandparent. But at the very end, he points out that the noble person understands them as the human way. That is, it is these are rituals one performs as a way of expressing grief. But it is the hundred names, that is, the common people, who think of them as matters actually having to do with spirits. So in this particular passage from Xunzi, this is one of the best examples of this skepticism articulated by some Confucians about whether or not all of these ancestral rituals really involved spirits or whether they did not. It's my sense that most people did think these ancestral rituals involved actual spirits, but there were skeptics, and Xunzi is a good example of them. Another slightly alternative description, a way of explaining these ancestral rites, comes from a passage here by Zhu Xi. Zhu Xi was the Neo-Confucian systematizer of the 12th century, and basically, in brief, what he did was he was one of the very few people who attempted to come up with a systematic way of understanding all of the classical texts, to give all of these classical texts a certain coherence. He did so by writing commentaries to all of the classics and to a number of additional Confucian texts, and he then faced certain problems. Some texts clearly did not think there were spirits, and some texts clearly did think there were spirits. You know, when we analyze these texts today, we simply recognize that these texts came from different traditions, and that's why they don't cohere, they don't make sense together. But Zhu Xi was trying to come up with a way for them all to make sense. He devised a particular metaphysical system based on the circulation of material force. And so he imagined that at death, material force disintegrates. However, it does not disintegrate completely at once, however. And therefore, in religious sacrifice, we have the principle of spiritual influence and response. Since those who perform sacrificial rites are their descendants, the material force between them is, after all, the same. Hence, there is the principle by which they can penetrate and respond. So he comes up with some sort of metaphysical explanation for the ancestral rites, where they still make sense, even though there are not necessarily spirits, because they have disintegrated with material force. Nevertheless, it can be explained through his particular metaphysical system. Okay, so now I want to move on. I've talked about the ancestral cult, what one might associate with the Hun soul, that is the soul that rises up upon death. And now I want to move on to the tomb itself and what was the function of the tomb and of the contents of tombs. And I think a very useful way of understanding tombs is to think of them as being essentially designed as a way of keeping the paw soul inside. So part of the way you keep the soul inside is, well, you cover it up with dirt and try to keep the soul from making its way outside of the tomb. But the other strategy was to provide a very enjoyable environment to keep the soul happy. And in fact, as we'll see, many of these elite tombs designed these tombs as basically sites of an afterlife banquet. They were basically banqueting, listening to music, eating wonderful food continuously in this underground chamber. This was one of the strategies for keeping the souls within the tomb. Okay, now I'll mention very briefly a shift in tomb architecture that happened right around the beginning of the Han Dynasty. So there was an older style of elite tombs that consisted of basically pits in which the coffin and the grave goods were lowered down, and then the whole area was then covered up with dirt. This is an example of such a casket tomb, and this is one of the latest ones that has been found. This is a famous tomb in Hunan province at Mawangdui, dating to, again, the early Western Han, so the 2nd century BCE. Here is a diagram of that tomb where you can see that essentially, well, there was a pit was dug, there was a ramp created to help lower the casket down into the pit, but the overall idea of this was that everything was getting lowered into a hole in the ground and was then covered up with dirt. After the Western Han Dynasty, there was a shift towards the creation of chambers that much more closely resembled actual homes, actual houses. They incorporated certain architectural features of houses above ground. So this is an example of an elite tomb from the 10th century. And basically what you had was a ramp that went down to a doorway that then through which you entered the tomb chamber itself. Now this ramp was later covered up with dirt, so the chamber was entirely separate from the world above ground, but nevertheless, the architecture of this chamber shared certain features of constructions above ground, and so one can think of them, in fact, as being much more like a home for the deceased, more so than the earlier style of tomb, the caskets that were lowered into pits. Within these chambered tombs, very often one encounters on the murals, and sometimes these are done with in relief using a particular masonry technique where the bricks actually protrude out from the wall. This is especially common in the 10th, 11th, 12th, and 13th centuries. But these murals then depict domestic scenes of various sorts. So here we have a woman washing her face or maybe washing clothing in a basin. One has a coat rack and various other pieces of furniture on the right. But then also these tombs include actual architectural elements within them. Here I've marked some of the bracketing structures on the roof of this tomb. These bracketing structures do not actually serve any functional role in terms of maintaining the stability of the roof, but what they are designed to do is imitate the sort of wooden brackets that one found in wooden structures that date to this period. So they were clearly designed to imitate above-ground architecture. It was not the above-ground architecture itself, but it was designed to imitate it. It was designed to, as much as possible, make the chamber appear and feel like the interior of an actual home. Again, the idea is that this was what the spirit would want, to feel like the spirit was at home. In the tombs, however, it's clear that there is a distinction between a certain relationship to the world that living beings have versus those that deceased beings have. There was a different logic, and in particular, in the world of the afterlife, a lot could happen through some sort of virtual reality. That is, models of things could actually serve functional purposes, could come to life and become a real thing in the world of the spirits. One of the best examples of this is actually paper goods. And as early as the 8th century, people would burn fake money, fake paper money. And this was a way of transmitting this money to the deceased. So again, it's it's not real in the sense that it's usable by the people in the living world, but it was usable by the people, by the deceased in the afterlife. There was a different way in which things worked in the afterlife, and this is important because it explains why models and why murals on walls could actually come to life and could actually be of use to the deceased. So a lot of the figurines in tombs were in fact designed to be functionally useful for the deceased. The most famous would be probably the terracotta warriors at the emperor at the tomb of the first emperor. These were of course not real people, and it was important that there once had been human sacrifice in a Chinese death ritual. When that was eliminated, what took its place were figurines that served the same function. They could serve the deceased in the afterlife and in this sense come to life. So one does encounter among figurines sometimes soldiers such as these, but one also encounters a variety of servants or cooks such as the two figures depicted here. One encounters domestic animals, again, that would serve the deceased as a real animal might have served the individual while the individual was still alive. And then one also finds various miniature models, such as this model of a mill or this model of a granary. All of these would be no function. They would serve no purpose for the living, but they did serve a function for the deceased. They could be used by the deceased in the tomb, in the chamber of the tomb, which worked according to different principles, not the same principles that we're used to in the world of the living. Now, one of the most important functions of the tomb, besides to recreate the domestic interior, was to establish a venue for an afterlife banquet to keep the soul of the deceased that's in the tomb, to keep the soul happy for eternity. One finds some elements of this afterworld banquet actually on display. So this is a tomb that dates to the late 11th century, and when the archaeologist excavated it, the coffin was still intact, as well as in front of the coffin, there were a number of dishes that had various foods that had been offered to the deceased. And there was also, in fact, several wine vessels in back, one of which had actually gotten, the lid had fused sufficiently that to create a hermetic seal so that there actually was still liquid within the vessel. Now, it was not just through these actual objects that the soul was able to enjoy this afterlife banquet. It was also through a virtual reality that was created by the murals on the wall of the tomb. So you have here, so the entrance of the tomb is coming up from the bottom. This would be the south side of the tomb, the entrance. Then you have this antechamber, and then the main room of the chamber with the rectangle on top being the coffin of the deceased. And incidentally, this was a cremation burial, and hence the shape of the coffin. Now, in the antechamber, you have a depiction both of musicians and also of people preparing tea. So again, two elements of what was deemed to be essential for this afterlife banquet, to make sure that the soul of the deceased was kept content within the chamber of the tomb. There was also interesting ways in which the mural, the program on the mural, was integrated into the space of the interior of the tomb. So you have, for example, a painting of a woman lighting a candle, or not a candle, but a lamp, an oil lamp, lighting an oil lamp. And what's interesting is that then projecting out of the wall of the tomb is an actual little platform on which one did, I don't know if they found it in this tomb, but they have in some of these tombs found an actual lamp placed on top of that, so that it was lit at one point, probably during the burial itself, and provides a good example of how this sort of virtual reality of the mural was integrated into the actual space of the tomb, so that it was very ambiguous what was real and what was simply depicted in murals. And you know, the explanation for that is simply that from the perspective of the deceased, it did not matter, that both of these things came together and came to life for the deceased in the tomb. Here's another example of this phenomenon in this, again, another tomb from the 11th century. You have a woman who would be a servant, so this is a scene where they are preparing tea. The tea is poured into a little bowl that is being balanced on a cup holder that has a very distinctive shape, this cup holder on which the cup of tea is being balanced. And then this cup itself is then reappears. So here's a detail of the cup. And then it reappears in reality on the table in front of the coffin of the deceased. So again, there's this interesting interplay between the murals and the physical objects within the tomb. There's also a number of other ways in which this afterlife banquet is depicted, again, with the goal, once again, is to keep the deceased happy. In some cases, especially in the region of, in the North China Plain and the Yellow River Valley, the middle and lower reaches, it was common to it's common to find tombs where you actually have either the deceased couple depicted on the mural enjoying the afterlife banquet, or you have, so that's such as on the image to the right, or on the image to the left, you have two chairs facing each other at a table, but where the deceased are not actually sitting there, and so presumably it was the spirits of the deceased that would come up and join in with the mural and enjoy the feast. And one thing that is, I think, quite striking is that this was indeed this afterlife banquet, the way it is depicted, is very reminiscent of the afterlife, or of the actual banquets depicted in paintings of the same period, so of, roughly speaking, the 11th century. And in particular, what is worth noting are the is this object here, which is in this case, it's not tea, this is wine. So actually below the table, you have a vessel that holds the wine. This, and it's kept hot down here. It is then poured into this vessel, this ewer here, which is itself placed within a warming bowl. It's placed within a bowl that where one can add hot water to keep it warm. From the ewer, it is then poured into these cups that are then balanced on these cup stands. And you have a similar depiction here of the ewer and the warming bowl and then the cup and the cup stands, although they're a little less clear because part of the mural has disintegrated. Now here, what you have is a very famous painting of Han Shizai's night revelry. So this is a famous painting depicting a minister of the Southern Tang during the 10th century, who was known for having these wonderful parties at his house at night. And it's interesting then to see, what did it mean to enjoy life at these evening banquets? It meant, besides sitting in front of a table with ewers of wine in these warming bowls with cups balanced on cup stands. So essentially the exact same utensils that one finds on the table in front of the deceased. So again, I think a very nice way of illustrating the fact that, again, this was an afterlife banquet. It was intended to be to keep the deceased happy, to be enjoyable to the deceased, in the same way that these banquets of the world of the living kept this particular minister happy, that one that he found enjoyable. There's a couple of interesting twists on this, on how these tombs functioned, one of which had to do with cremation burial, which became gradually more common beginning in roughly the 10th and 11th century. Cremation burial was associated with Buddhism. There was no cremation burial prior to the emergence of Buddhism. And it was really only in the late first millennium that you start to have commonly find tombs with cremation burial. And this creates an interesting problem. What does the deceased, can the deceased still enjoy the afterlife banquet without, you know, if the remains have been cremated? And one interesting solution to the problem that was not always turned to, but in some specific tombs, especially in the Northeast, was these fully articulated wooden mannequins in which the ashes of the deceased were placed. And so this was a way of giving a new body to the deceased. It was not the actual body of the living. It was a virtual body that could thus take part in this virtual banquet that was part of the program of the interior of the tomb. Here's another view of one of these wooden mannequins, where you can clearly see a board which would have been removed, and the ashes of the deceased would have been placed inside. One final way of illustrating how these tombs functioned and the way in which they actually served a specific role for keeping the soul of the deceased happy is to look at some of the popular tales of the Tang Dynasty, these tales dealing with ghosts that people encounter in various places. In this story is actually one, it's just a section of the story, but it is an account of someone who broke into the tomb of an emperor of 1500 years earlier, or a king of 1500 years earlier, and describes what he sees. And what he sees is all of the decorations come to life. They become real within the space of the tomb. So it is no longer just, there are actual incense burners. There were sweet-smelling smoke of incense. And then later on in this description, although it's not translated, there's actual descriptions of maidservants coming up to this guy and offering him food and beverages. So again, the tomb comes to life. In reality, we're talking about murals painted on the walls, but when this guy breaks into the tomb, there's a different logic that happens within the space of the tomb. The tomb comes to life, and so the tomb really is the site of this afterlife banquet. Another sort of tale that one frequently encounters is something sort of like this, where you have a man traveling, or for some reason he's out of town, and in fact we later find out he's near a cemetery. And so in this particular case we have a description of this guy, Changsun Shaozu, who is traveling between two places. He encounters a dwelling next to the road. It's late at night, so he's looking to see if he can lodge there for the night. You know, presumably you could pay people to just stay in their house if you needed to. And then as he approaches the house, he hears the sound of a harp being plucked. He peeks through the window. He sees a lovely young woman, and then the woman seduces him. The next morning, he wakes up. The woman wipes away tears, says, "I will not see you again. Here is a keepsake to remember me by." And then as he leaves, he rides away. He looks back, and the house has disappeared. All he sees is a small grave. And then he looks at the box that he was given, this keepsake, and it turns out to be something that is not of no use in the realm of the living. So it's one of these things that was of use in this space of the tomb, where things acquired this virtual reality, where things came to life. Things that had no use in the world of living were of use in the world of the dead. And I think this is, again, a nice illustration of this that one sees in these sorts of tales from the Tang Dynasty. So I don't want to say much more. I have a few other things to point out, but I don't really want to say anything about them except to use them as illustrations of the fact that there were other practices that don't fit in nicely with the story that I told before. There are accounts of paradises. If you have a soul going into an ancestral tablet, a soul going into the tomb, where does the paradise fit in? Who's going to the paradise? Very unclear, but there are stories of this. There are accounts of the Queen Mother of the West and her paradise on the on Mount Kunlun, depicted in these illustrations. This then is transformed into the Western paradise of the Amitabha Buddha. Once Buddhism becomes prevalent in China, again, how does a soul go both into the ancestral tablet, into the tomb, and to the Western paradise? It's unclear. This is never resolved. And then, of course, most notably is this idea of reincarnation that the Buddhists brought. If you have the ancestral spirit that survives after death, how can the deceased also be reincarnated? These beliefs, though, did coexist with each other. The same people sacrificed to their ancestors while also going to Buddhist temples. It reminds us, I think, that when, in fact, in the reality of the world, people often aren't able to make complete sense of everything, and life goes on nevertheless. So I think I'll actually stop here. I had a few more slides just to illustrate this point, but I think it would be useful to take a few questions, so why don't I stop here then? You know, I don't think there's ever a real explanation for these two souls, and I actually attribute it to simply the fact that there were two traditions, that at some point there was an effort to explain both of these traditions, and hence the two souls. The classical texts often refer to these two elements, the Hun and the Po soul. There are numerous descriptions of death involving the separation of these souls. Presumably, if they came back together, you would come back to life. But death involves the separation of these souls. There are interesting explanations of basically haunting ghosts, and this involves unhappy paw souls. And very often, one will discover there'll be this ghost that is causing problems, and then someone finally figures out that this is the ghost that lives in a tomb that has collapsed, let's say. So then a new tomb is dug, the remains are transferred, and then the ghost doesn't cause problems anymore. So this would be a problem that would happen if the paw soul comes out and becomes a ghost.
Hi, can you talk a little bit about the relationship of couples in these tombs? Are the couples buried next to each other? What happens if you have many wives? Some Etruscan sarcophaguses, the couples are actually holding each other. Does that ever happen?
Okay, so that's a good question. I think that there's a tendency to have a male and female couple within a tomb, that is the ideal. Plenty of these elite men, so we're talking about the tombs of elites, these more elaborate tombs that we've been looking at, these elite men would have had concubines, the children of whom were their legitimate heirs. So the concubines had a place in the family, but they were generally not buried within the tomb. They were buried maybe next to the tomb in a separate tomb. But generally, in these chambered tombs that I've shown you, the ideal was to have a male and female couple. They were, of course, not buried at the same time. There was no, you know, there were no cases. There may have been cases in the very early period of women being killed as part of the burial ritual, but by the imperial period, this didn't happen. And so the tomb would, in fact, have to be either reopened, or in some cases, if one of the member of the couple died first, there was a temporary burial, or the sarcophagus was set aside waiting for an actual burial where the two could be buried together. They were always in separate coffins, though. They were never within the same coffin. And so this, but it, yeah, I think this is the, this you know, a general explanation of the situation.
Hello, we know from around about the Shung Dynasty period that there was human sacrifice and animal sacrifice. They were marched in and killed with their kings and emperors. At what point in time did that stop and was replaced with statuary?
Okay, so that's a good question. It's, you know, it seems as though the last clear examples of human sacrifice date to the middle of the first millennium BC. It's not exactly clear to me when specifically, but as of the middle of the first millennium, you still have texts that are critical of the practice. So it seems to be that this was when it was really dying out. And then by the imperial period, so by the late third century, there was absolutely no evidence of human sacrifice. There were still probably animal sacrifices under various circumstances. You know, various regional traditions would still include the sacrifice of animals. You know, even today, animals are sacrificed in certain traditions. My wife is Chinese, and my in-laws, I've seen them sacrifice a chicken to the earth god. So this is still done, but certainly not humans. There were some odd examples of human sacrifice in later periods, but these were isolated. There was cases in the south of feeding maidens to keep the dragons in these lakes happy, or in these salt mines happy, but it was certainly something condemned by the political authorities. But the animal sacrifices were still widespread.
I was just wondering, you use the term Taoist priests and mm-hmm. Buddhist monks. A monk is somebody who tends to be reclusive, or a hermit. I mean, you live in a monastery. Mm-hmm. I'm just wondering, I've never heard of Buddhist priests and Taoist monks. Why is that? Is there a difference between a monk and a priest?
Well, the terms I usually encounter are monks are the Buddhists and priests are the Taoists. You know, that's the terms I've generally heard. The Buddhist monks, there's a number of ways in which the history of Buddhism is as it is narrated in English by Western scholars has been inspired by histories of Christianity. And it's actually often misleading, because you end up with, if you're ever reading a history of Buddhism and it sounds like a history of Christianity, it's probably because there's a problem. And I think that that's why monks are used. But the Buddhist monks, why this term monk is used, the Buddhist monks were in principle celibate, so I think that there was then this idea, and then they lived in a temple compound. And so these temple compounds are then commonly called monasteries, and the Buddhists are then living there are then called monks or nuns if they're female. So this is, I think, the source of this terminology. The Taoist priests are, you know, not necessarily celibate, but though they will also generally live in the temple compound. So in many ways, they are functionally very similar to the Buddhists, but they are, in English, they're usually not referred to as monks, but as priests.
Hi, I really was interested in the slide you showed that had the comparison of the mural and then the painting that I guess was on a scroll. And to me, the depiction of space in the two seemed really different. And I was just wondering if you knew anything about the stylistic difference, or if you would say that there was a stylistic difference between the way the space looks.
I mean, I think that you know, I think that there's a variety of ways of characterizing the difference in how the space is painted. I think it's very difficult to tell what where the distinction is simply different painting styles and where it's actually you know, functionally important in terms of how the tomb worked. One thing I did not mention, which I probably should have, is that this is actually not the original, this is actually a painting that is, you know, a modern reconstruction of the original painting from the tomb, and this is very common in depictions, in published descriptions of tombs, that the original is so faint that someone has done a reproduction to try to show what it originally looked like. So that could explain some of the weird elements of this painting. But I think that from my perspective, I think that the major explanation of the difference is that is simply painting style, that the person, the sort of people involved painting these scrolls had much higher status. They would have been court painters, whereas the people painting in the tomb murals were unnamed craftspeople who had very different technical skills. But I think it is nevertheless important that what they see as sort of the way of representing an ideal, you know, evening, an ideal evening banquet, that it contains very similar elements. I think that's really what's important here.
Do we know how the farmers and artisans and, for want of a better term, the common people whose labor made possible these luxurious lifestyles and death styles, if you will, of the elites, do we know how they felt about this? And if we do, like, what evidence are we basing that on?
Yeah, I think one knows very little about what they felt. One has the elite accounts of them, which tends to be, you know, either happy or, you know, kind of stupid and just moving, yeah, simple and just moving on with their lives. So I don't, there's never, you know, one rarely sees accounts that are useful for trying to reconstruct what they actually felt. There's kind of a, you know, it's kind of this ludicrous account of there's a family manual that dates to the 12th century. So it's a manual by a man who wanted to all of his descendants to sort of know how to manage a household. And there's this very peculiar line where he says, it starts out with, sometimes maids will hang themselves for no reason at all, right? So it's sort of like there's no attempt to even understand why someone would kill themselves. You know, presumably they were rather unhappy in the in the household, but the head of the household is utterly oblivious to this, so these sorts of accounts don't help us much. There's also a problem that then on the flip side you have the Marxist historians who sort of read class struggle into everything, and every time you have a rebellion, it turns into a class uprising, and that too is probably not correct. It's probably all sorts of various factors explaining these rebellions. So it's very hard to actually get at what non-literate people were thinking.
What was the main reason that human sacrifices stopped?
That's a good question. Why did human sacrifices stop? I don't know. It's it's typically the historians just kind of assume that as civilizations progress, they one of the natural things they eliminate as part of the process of becoming more civilized is human sacrifice, but there's no particular reason to assume that this would be the case. And you know, it's clear that the that a lot of the moral text of this period condemned human sacrifice, but you know, why they were listened to and why they were not just ignored is unclear. I don't think there's a very good explanation.
Dr. Tackett, you talked briefly about Confucian rituals or the fact that they were co-opted from previous. I understand Confucianism in the little bit that I know as a sort of social organization, political system. Mm-hmm. I teach art history, but many of my students who are Asian tell me that Confucianism is a religion. And we've had this discussion, and I'm just wondering if you could touch on that a little bit.
Right. So yeah, that's a good question, and there's no really clear answer. Basically, all sorts of different things are part of this Confucian tradition. There is a reading of Confucianism as a philosophy, basically a moral philosophy that provides instructions on proper ways of behaving, in which case there's absolutely no religious element whatsoever. And it's pretty easy to read Confucianism in this way if you read translations of the Confucian texts based on the Neo-Confucian commentaries, based on Zhuxi's commentaries. You end up with that reading. But then it's clear that the Confucian specialists, that the Confucian masters at court were involved in these very large rituals that were intended to, you know, sort of bridge the heavens to the earth through the emperor and through the emperor's performance of these great sacrifices. And so there, you know, there is this, one of the problems, of course, is that it is ultimately a sort of modern Western thing to categorize, to distinguish different types of knowledge, to distinguish philosophy from religion, et cetera. In fact, people thought of all of this as true and equally true. So this sort of categorization is not terribly useful. But if one has an intuitive sense of what one means by religion, then surely these great sacrifices were religious. And the other way in which you can see Confucius and Confucianism as being religious-like is that you then had Confucian temples, which still exist today, where there's a statue of Confucius, and people will offer and make sacrifices. You know, they'll offer fruit and burn incense in front of the statue. And today, it often will be in order to say, if they're about to take exams and they want to do well on the exams, then they will go to the Confucian temple, in much the same way that you might go to a Buddhist temple when you have other concerns. And so there, surely you could call that religious. So it sort of depends how it's being practiced, whether you want to call it a religion, a philosophy, or something else.
Yes, could you tell us if construction began after the subject had passed away, or perhaps before, and if it was before, did they have any decision making in what may be in there or how it would be set up?
Right. I guess I don't really know. I know that there are, in the case of, one doesn't have many accounts of the actual construction of the tomb. It's clear that there was often a delay of up to a year, so there would have been ample time to construct these tombs after the death. In the case of many of the imperial tombs, where one actually does have a chronology of events, usually the tomb was constructed afterwards, but there are accounts of the tomb being constructed beforehand, presumably if the emperor was particularly sure of how big he wanted his tomb. Now, obviously, after death, they would not have played a direct role in the content, but generally, you know, the immediate relatives would have been in charge of this. And there were efforts to make the tomb appeal in the context of knowing the personality of the deceased. There's a few examples of this. There's a distinction also between the objects that go in the tomb and the objects that go in the coffin. And very often the objects going in the coffin were personal items of the deceased that the deceased was supposed to have cherished in life. I have seen at least one inscription where it's clearly stated that these objects were provided because it was the deceased who liked these objects. So I think there was an effort made in that regard.
I understand you're here to talk about tombs and of Han Dynasty, but I had a question about maybe a little bit more modern burial practices. When I went to China to visit my village, I saw bone jars of my ancestors, and I'd never heard of bone jars before. Do you have any information about them?
Where was this?
Canton.
Okay. Yeah, I'm not familiar with that practice. That was certainly not a practice that was common or described in the period that I look at. It is true, I will say that, you know, there's a lot of the southern practices were very probably pre-Chinese, because the Chinese gradually spread southward, and a lot of the people living in the south are continuing traditions that began before the Chinese came down. So a lot of the southerners, you know, so there's a lot of traditions in the south that are completely alien from my perspective when I look at the Tang Song and I'm looking basically at the Yellow River and Yangtze River valleys.
Great, did we get everyone's questions? Thank you so much, that was so fascinating.
Thank you.